as we gather together as church. You guys know for the last couple of months, we've been having church with this place. You can hear the echo, for those of you tuning in online and so forth. And we're starting to address that. You all are starting to deaden the noise in here a little bit. I appreciate that. As we gather together here in the very perfect presence of God, it is good to be together. I'd like to direct your attention to the bulletin. If you're not in the habit of looking at the service flow, there are slight changes. Some of the changes are going to be how we do communion, how we collect our offering, and how you'll leave the sanctuary at the end. You'll be ushered out from the back pews, working our way toward the front. And so really what we would invite you to do, especially since this is our early service, if you're going to join us for Bible class downstairs, following the service, head directly down there. I know the temptation is to congregate, and you know that we're trying to resist that and trying to distance ourselves, obviously, for good reason. If you're not going to be able to come to Bible class, maybe you're going to watch it online, we just encourage you at the end of the service, keep heading outside. If you want to chat outside on the sidewalk where you can kind of have some space, that's wonderful. One of the things I have found, I have had my hands in my pockets when I'm walking around here. I'm a handshaker, and I barely survive on a Sunday morning. I'm giving a hug, a squeeze, a hand on the shoulder. So if you walk in and my hands are behind my back, I'm not hiding anything. I'm just trying to practice some good distancing, some good measures. It is great to be together as church. For those of you tuning in online, and I know it feels odd for you for me to just talk over here, but for those of you, we're going to continue to stream services 8 a.m. For church and 9:30 for Bible class on Facebook. And for you, make sure that if you want to share those, as always, to be able to share them with friends and things so that people stay connected. Some people are unable to get out, so they're not willing to come out yet. And as a result of that, we want to still make sure we can be church. To still communicate those elements of God's truth and God's hope and promise. You figured out the seating in here, right? I told you to sit in the comfortable seats. And so to help you with that, we've removed the pews from every other seat. So you guys have figured that out. Just distance yourself left and right, and you guys are doing a good job with that. Don't forget that we've got extra seating upstairs in the balcony, over here in the bump out, in the back, in the narthex. And I pray that distancing relaxes as numbers grow, as people continue to come out, because we're going to run out of space in here before long. And I praise God for that, and hopefully that balance will come out. Well, we can't stand up and greet one another with a handshake or a hug, but could you stand up, give a big smile, and just welcome people this morning? Let's stand.
Rejoice.
find on the screens. We speak these words together.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I invite the congregation to be seated at this time. We recognize as we gather in the very perfect presence of God, no matter where we gather, that we come up well short of God's expectation of holiness. He created us in perfection, but we fell. And so we take this opportunity to confess those sins, sins that we are aware of, and also sins that we've already discarded as unimportant. And so I want to encourage you to take up the posture of a repentant people this morning. Maybe slide forward where you're seated, folding your hands over the pew in front of you, and let's speak these words of confession. We confess together. Please hear my confession, O God.
I, a poor sinner, plead guilty before you of all sins. I have lived as if you did not have, and as if I had been most. Your name I have not honored as I should. My worship and prayers have faltered. I have not let your love have its way with me, and so my love for others has failed. There are those whom I have hurt, and those whom I have failed to help. My thoughts and desires have been spoiled with sin. Forgive my sin, O God, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus.
And that's true. We've all fallen well short of God's expectation of holiness. But this is precisely why God came in the flesh, to do what you and I could never do. We can't make it right. But God himself took on human flesh, lived the life you and I could never live, a perfect one, died the death that our sin demands, faced our hell, and the holy and righteous judgment of his Father. When he burst forth from that tomb on Easter morning, he declared once and for us all that sin, because of Jesus, is no more. That death is not the end. And the power of Satan is forever confounded and broken. And so as God's spokesman to you today, I announce to you with great joy and absolute conviction in the promise and the provision of the Word of God that your sin, my sin, all of it, is completely, totally forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit back for our first scripture reading.
Our first reading comes to us this morning from the 17th chapter of the book of Acts, starting with the 22nd verse. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. Nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of which their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said. For we are indeed his offspring, Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God had overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes to us today from the third chapter of the first book of Peter, starting with the 13th verse. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in the prison, because they formerly did not obey. When God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand out of respect for God and his word. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Oh,
heads. Let's begin this time of prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the power of your Spirit among your people. He is the giver of faith, the revealer of secrets. And so, Lord, may we lean into his presence within our hearts and the effect upon our minds and our lives. Lord, we want to be your church. That's my prayer today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In your bulletins, you will find an outline, as always. And if you've gotten used to the one online and all the answers are filled in, right, you're going to have to do a little more work this morning. Now, for you at home online, it's still filled in. So I really want to encourage you to follow along. There are opportunities to learn things that you might kind of glean from this morning's time that will help you, I pray, in conversations. Maybe it's within your own family, maybe it's within people you know, or people that you just kind of serendipitously come in contact with. Be the first one at dinner time to use the word serendipitously today. That's a good word, right? I played a lot of Scrabble over this quarantine time. Underneath the outline, there's a series of Bible readings there as well. Please take advantage of those if you're not in the habit of being in the Word of God. That's a great discipline. Let God speak to you and transform you and train you. And each one of those readings, one per day, really takes what we talk about on Sunday here and really kind of continues to grow it. Many of you know that before I was a pastor, I worked with teenagers. I was a teacher, and then I was a DCE, they would call it, and then even my first call as a pastor in St. Louis, I worked with teenagers, high schoolers, college students, and so forth. Now, for several of those years, naturally, people started kind of asking me questions about how do you take care of youth? Since I had spent half of my adult life working with them, those questions came up. And naturally, as I served within the church, there was a need to train other adult leaders as they would come into the ministry wanting to make an impact to help youth come to know their Lord and Savior. So I used a simple guide for each adult that came into and wished to help in the youth ministry and serve, and it goes a little something like this. If you want to make a difference in a young person's life, if you want to change a life, they need to trust you. And they're not going to trust you until they know you. And they're not going to be able to know you until you spend time with them. It's really kind of a simple guideline for us. For a few decades, as I cared for those youth around me, I knew they weren't going to listen to anything I said until they trusted me. And they weren't going to trust me until they knew me. They weren't going to be able to know me until I spent time with them. Now, I want you to know, if you are aptly impressed by that system, it is not mine. I learned about that when I read a particular book. You see, it's God's guide for us as he approaches his children. You see, God intends to change a life, eternally speaking. In fact, he's done this by inviting us to trust him. And he has spent all of human history defending and demonstrating his trustworthiness. In fact, the entirety of the Old Testament is an ongoing testimony to God being trustworthy. No matter our disobedience or our rebellion or our irreverence, he kept his promise to send a Redeemer to fix what we broke. And then, after a long-awaited period of time, God fulfilled his promise by coming in the flesh, by being born as a baby in Bethlehem. And he did all of this so that we could know God himself. And through Jesus, we learned about his heart, God's desire for us, God's plans to redeem this world once and for all by his innocent life and death and resurrection. And all this happens as God chooses to spend time.
with us. And he chooses to do that through his presence in the person of the Holy Spirit. From our gospel reading that Keith read just moments ago in verse 16 of John 14, it says, "And I will," that's Jesus, "ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever." Forever. That's some serious time. God, in his love, he wants to redeem us. He wants to change our lives forever. And because our sin and because our shortcomings, he draws us to him by demonstrating that God is indeed trustworthy. And he's chosen the best way to demonstrate that trust to us is to walk this life with us. That's what Jesus did. And then as Jesus returns to heaven, he asks his Father for help. So the Father gives another helper. A helper that would remain with his people, spending time in the hearts of his people stretching into eternity. Now, if the Holy Spirit is another helper, then who is the previous helper? Well, it's pretty safe that any question that happens within the bounds of a sermon, the answer is always Jesus. And this is no different. You see, all through the Old Testament, there was talk about a Messiah, starting all the way back in the Garden of Eden, one that would come that would help in ways that mankind never could. That's why we confess our sins this morning. A Savior that would come to redeem a lost and condemned world. And now that Jesus is ascending in our gospel back to heaven, there is a need for another helper. One that will grant God's real presence. One that will give gifts that come with it to those called to be witnesses in this post-resurrection world. And so the Father grants the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Holy Spirit, church, is essential to God's work in this world. So whether through the waters of holy baptism or by receiving the saving good news of the gospel, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in the hearts of people. In fact, in Acts 2, in the early church, it says these words, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." And I want you to understand that the Holy Spirit is the gift. And it's promised to all you that have been baptized into faith or have heard and received the good news of the gospel. Because in Romans chapter 10 it says, "So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ." And so here's why this is so important for us this morning. This is why, don't miss this, this is why I made the statement in our title of this sermon this morning, that you cannot love God. That is a bold statement, but it is a statement that is absolutely true. You and I cannot love God without help. In fact, to be more specific, without the helper. You cannot love God without the Holy Spirit. Let's make sure we're clear about that so we don't leave today saying, "My pastor told me I can't love God." The Holy Spirit is essential because he's the giver of faith. He alone is the one that enables us to express anything worthy to God. And that is why Jesus' statement in the gospel, "If you love me," verse 15, "you will keep my commandments." That's why this statement is so compelling. And here's why. First, let's backtrack a little bit. How do you know God? Think about it. Maybe this question. How do you know there is a God? Now, if you think you've just figured it out, that means you think it comes down to your intellect. If it comes down to our intellect, that means we don't need grace. You just have to be smart enough in order to be saved. Now, God does claim that it's clear that 1:20. It says, for his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and his divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. Church, that means that the world and the universe are simple, clear evidence that there is a creator. Now, who gives you that insight? John 16:14, a little bit after our gospel, it says, he will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. That's the Holy Spirit. So that gets us to there being a God that creates. That's not it. See, there's a second question that continues to feed us. Not just how do you know God, now where do you learn of God? Now there's natural revelation that we get through creation that there is indeed a creator, but nature does not proclaim that there's a man named Jesus of Nazareth that lived, died, and rose again for you. That comes through the inerrant revelation of Scripture, the Word. And the only way that you and I can understand the revelation of the Word is through the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12, Paul writes, therefore I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is accursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. I used to teach it this way to my confirmation students. The Holy Spirit has the dimmer switch on the Holy Scriptures to be able to illuminate parts of it for us. He's where revelation and understanding of Scripture come from. And as a result of both God's clear identity through nature and the divine Scriptures, what have you been given? It is also from the Holy Spirit, and only from the Holy Spirit, and that is faith. And so Romans 10:17, it says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. All this is to say that the presence of the Holy Spirit is imperative to being a believer. Imperative. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 2, he says, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. And so, church, Jesus' statement in our gospel, verse 15 again, where he says, if you love me, you will keep my commands. My commandments. It demonstrates that statement, the work of the Holy Spirit. You see, we can only love as the Spirit works within us and through us. Anything God-honoring coming out of us comes from God, the Holy Spirit. Let me give you an example. Galatians chapter 5, the fruits of the Spirit. And look at the first one. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. You cannot have godly love without godly involvement. And he goes on, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Church, I want you to understand that not one of those traits originates in us. They're all from the working of the Holy Spirit within us. And when we seek to obey his commandments, that second part of that verse, remember Philippians 2, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The Holy Spirit is absolutely crucial to the life moving in the direction of heaven. And when we make mistakes and missteps, the Spirit reminds us of the truth of Scripture. Because remember, he is the Spirit of truth. In fact, from our epistle reading from 1 Peter, it says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. When we fail and fall short, the Holy Spirit reminds us of that truth. Jesus has paid the price. Again, it is God's deepest desire for you to be with him, so that he can have an eternal impact on you. That's why he gave his Holy Spirit to us. So baptized and believers, you have him within you. So stop hindering the Holy Spirit. That's the reason that you and I struggle obeying God's commands. It's why marriages struggle being selfless. It's why parents lose their tempers and lose their way. It's why we have more fears than courage. It's why we doubt. It's why we're anxious. And it's why we stress over the future. The Spirit is within you. You have to stop blocking him. We have to let him mold and shape us. In fact, I'm going to give you something today that will change everything. Memorize this prayer. Come, Holy Spirit. If you're struggling in any way in your life, in your marriage, in your relationship, pray that prayer. And open yourself, avail yourself to God. Now, you're not actually inviting him to some place that he isn't already there. But you are sensitizing yourself and making yourself aware that you're engaging with the work of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus bookends our reading today, listen to what he says. I'll start with verse 15. He says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." And then the back end of our reading, it says, "Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." Let's be clear. God doesn't love us if we keep his commands. We can't. He loves us when the Holy Spirit is given access to our hearts and our minds. And he works within us, connecting us to him through the grace provided by the Savior's death and resurrection. Church, it means when the Spirit is working in us unhindered, our trust in God, our knowledge of God, and the fact that the Spirit is indeed working within us, it's going to look and sound a certain way. A certain way that I believe I have seen changes the world around us. It's what we call actively living for him. That's when we grant the Holy Spirit access to our hearts and minds so that we can obey his commands. That we can walk the way that Christ walked. To take up the calling of being light in this dark world. It's what he demonstrated in 1 Peter 3:15. It says, "But in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy." You can't do that without the Holy Spirit. And then it goes on, it says, "Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason of hope that is in you." You can't do that without the Holy Spirit. And yet do it with gentleness and respect. The Apostle John says this in his first letter, chapter 2. "And by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, 'I know Jesus,' but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Church, that truth is the Spirit of truth. The Holy Spirit himself. You and I proclaim Jesus as Lord when the Holy Spirit grants us that understanding and that revelation. So church, respond to the Holy Spirit. By his Spirit, repent to God. Love God, serve God, and actively live for him. Because you and I by ourselves cannot love God. We may do something that resembles it, But only by the Holy Spirit at work in us can you and I praise Him, love Him, serve Him, follow Him, and because of the Spirit one day be united to Him. Come, Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. At this time, I want to just remind you how we're going to gather our tithes and offerings. For those of you still at home, please send in your offerings or even bring it by sometime during the week. We'd love to see you. But for you that are here, we're going to bring our offerings forward as we're ushered forward for communion. Also, I'd encourage you to take one of those communication cards and jot some things down there, anything you're willing to share. Especially, church, those prayer requests. I have really missed the opportunity to lift those needs up for many of you. And so jot that down. When you come forward for communion, just drop your offering and those communication cards here in our prayer well, our multi-purpose prayer well. It's an opportunity for us to still stay connected as a church. Let's stand and pray.
On this day, for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the
Christ's sacrifice. He's here. And we trust that and we know that because of the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you share that belief with us, I invite you to come forward, receive the gifts of communion and the gifts that come with it of grace and forgiveness. But if you have a different set of beliefs, maybe you come from a different church background, or maybe you still have questions about what this meal is all about, I want you to know the Holy Spirit is continuing to work on your heart. But if that's you, I invite you to come forward, stand.
Congregation, please stand. And now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you to life everlasting. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace as you pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Trust in his spirit.